Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. We have a very busy show. We have Kari Sheldon, who is the head of the Mayor's Committee for People with Disabilities in St. Paul. They have a snow event coming up. And then Lisa Hiebert from Department of Public Works is going to be along. And then we have Laura Andert, who is a great advocate. And we got Joan Willshire as my co-host. So that's pretty action-packed right there. Joan, who do you have coming up?
Well, it's going to be a great little time when I'm up. Access Press, a newspaper here in the state and the only national newspaper that's disability-focused. I've got one of the board members coming in to talk about the organization and the big event they've coming up here in November.
I always say that's the Journal of the Disabled Community. So, Well, that sounds great. Look forward to hearing about that. And we'll have all that and more coming up next on Disability Viewpoints, which is right around the corner. Please stay tuned. First today, we have Kari Sheldon, who has been a resident of St. Paul since 1990. She is the current co-chair of the Mayor's Committee for People with Disabilities, or MACPD, if you like that, and also another advocate, like when the House and Senate are on, does a great job. So it's my honor to introduce Kari Sheldon. And to my right, we have Lisa Hiebert, who is Public Service Manager of the Department of Public Works in the City of St. Paul. She is one of the league organizers of the first annual Snow Summit being held in the city of St. Paul coming up this year in October. We're going to talk about that very thing right this minute. So what is the Snow Summit, and when and where will it be held?
Well, we're really excited to work with a lot of our community partners and organizations to offer and hold the first ever Snow Summit in St. Paul. It will be Saturday, October 14th. And we will be at the Dale Street Garage, so the municipal garage in St. Paul. It's 891 Dale Street. And it will be from 11 to 2, and it's free. And we invite all people to come out and learn about all things winter and get ready for the white stuff.
Wow, that sounds great. What are the goals of the Snow Summit? Who should attend? And what messages do you really hope to leave when the event ends?
The Mayor's Advisory Committee is basically the people who have pretty much started talking about this.
And, the brainchild.
And, yep. And we are the ones that are mostly responsible for getting the word out to help people with disabilities and business owners to make sure that the sidewalks are shoveled every year.
Why is this event important to both of you and each of you? And obviously it is. And why did the city decide to get behind it and coordinate the event?
Yeah, this is really an important event because whether you're a native Minnesotan who's lived here all your life or this is your first winter coming up in Minnesota, you're going to need to deal with snow and making sure that this is a city that works.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's going to come whether you like it or not. And just make sure that this is a city that works for all of us. That's really important to Mayor Carter and all of us who work for the city, of people of all abilities, so that you can get out and get around. And the Snow Summit is really about learning, again, all those rules and what you need to do, but also really kind of how can you enjoy winter, too? So
yes, how can you enjoy it? Tell me how you can enjoy it.
I mean, you can enjoy, you know, as a Minnesotan, you learn in layers and getting ready for it so that really you can try to live and enjoy everything that Minnesota has to offer all year round. But it does take some work. It does take some planning. And it really takes everybody working together throughout St. Paul, the city, the residents, the business owners, to make sure that people can get in, out, and around St. Paul.
Right, that's important. Mm-hmm. What other departments and government agencies will participate, Lisa?
Yeah, really excited. Again, this is truly a citywide event. The MACPD group will be there, as well as our libraries, our parks and recs, so kind of some fun things to get you into the spirit of winter. We will have our equipment out for all of our snow equipment, the plows. So if anybody likes to see the big trucks, great to see.
Yeah.
Fire department and pretty much all the departments of the city will be out there and represented. Great. And then having a lot of our great community partners there as well.
Great. Sounds like fun. Kari, can you describe to the audience how you move about the city of St. Paul and what it's like when the snow starts to fall?
Well, first I start out taking the bus, But when I get off the bus, I'm hoping that the shelters are going to be shoveled and the sidewalks and up to where I need to go. After I get frustrated and stuff like that, I end up having to call the city. But first, I end up talking to the business owner and explaining what the problem is. Then I end up calling the city, and they take it from there. And hopefully, the business will be notified on how to take care of their sidewalks.
And Lisa, I'm going to direct this next question to you, I think, first. What actions can a resident take when a sidewalk is not shoveled? Who do you contact and how?
Yeah, it's really important. In the city of St. Paul, property owners are responsible, or business owners are responsible, for shoveling their sidewalk. And if they're on a corner, that means all the way to the curb, including the ped ramp into the street. So it's critically important. If people are not shoveling their sidewalk, they can call the city and report it, and we can give that number and an email for that as well. And then what will happen is we will send out an inspector. They'll take a look at that, give a letter to the property owner to let them know that they're required to actually shovel their sidewalk within 24 hours of a snowstorm or a winter event ending. So they need to get out there pretty quick and do it. And if they're not, they'll get a letter from the city. And if they don't correct it, the city will send somebody out to shovel the sidewalks, and they will bill the property owner.
Have you ever been able to not leave your apartment building because the landlord hasn't shoveled?
Oh, yeah. I have had a lot of problems with that in the past. Mm-hmm. And I've had to go to the management and tell them this is the issue, and yep, this needs to be taken care of right away.
Okay, and then what if the bus stops are unshoveled? Does the city take care of this?
It kind of depends on what it is and where it is. So if it's a shelter, it is Metro Transit or the light rail platforms and things like that. Metro Transit is responsible for clearing all of that. If it's a bench, whoever is sponsoring the bench and they're supposed to be taking care of that space. What gets really tricky is when it's just a posted sign on a corner and there's not a shelter or a bench there. Technically, that one gets really tricky because property owners really should be shoveling that. A lot of property owners don't know that, and that gets really hard for a lot of property owners. So if I guess just to remind them, if that you do have a bus stop there, if you can kind of clear a little path and try to keep that open, right, that's going to be a huge help to everybody.
Okay. Should people shovel even if it's an inch or so?
Absolutely. We know here in Minnesota, after the most rainiest precipitation winter that we just had this past winter, it forms ice. So we have about 1,200 miles of sidewalk in St. Paul alone. And so even just if people can get that first dusting off and keep that clear and wide, and even just using just a little bit of salt, you don't need a ton of salt, but that is really going to help. It for the whole season.
Very, very quickly, about a minute left. Does the city have resources to help people shovel their sidewalks?
The city, we don't have resources directly, but there are some great organizations. There's the St. Lee City Snow Angels, where people can volunteer to sign up to help shovel sidewalks in their neighborhood for their residents, for their neighbors. And they can find it on our website.
And the last question quickly is, where should people put the snow?
That's always the tricky one.
Right.
When in doubt, if you can put it in your private yard or your private property first, that would be really great. Otherwise, there is public right-of-way and a boulevard right there.
Okay, very good. Thank you both for being on the show. October 14th is the event down in the Municipal Garage at 891 Dale Street. We hope to see you all there. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints right after this. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. My next guest is Laura Andert. She's a really good professional advocate and wants to tell her story quickly. So, Laura, welcome to the show.
I'm Laura Andert. As you said, I'm a disability advocate. I was born with cerebral palsy, and In the professional realm field, I am a disability consultant slash benefits coach for a company called Inclusive Networking. Mm-hmm. We help teach employers here in Minnesota how to hire people with disabilities, what all goes into that. And as a benefits coach, I help individuals with disabilities on Social Security benefits or other state and federal benefits, how to navigate that process. That can be very difficult.
Yeah.
I've always had the persevering positive mindset of with my disability. I always believed that I could conquer anything I wanted to if I had that perseverance and self-advocacy mindset. As I grew up, my parents, my sisters, I always thought I was more than capable of figuring out what I wanted to do in my future, mm-hmm. whether it's go to college or pursue working. And I pursued the work field. Mm-hmm. I knew college wasn't right for me. High school, elementary school, high school, I worked hard. I was an A and B student in special ed, but I just didn't want to go to college and go through all that. I knew I was meant for more in the work field. When it came to applying for jobs, I went into the places I wanted to work at and I presented myself. I go, here I am. I'm Laura Andert. I have a disability. I applied for your position, and I kept on following up, and I knew that was so important because the more we speak up, the more people are going to listen to what we need.
When you're conveying to the audience today, tell me what you'd like them to take away from listening to you, because you're a great communicator. I've always known that.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mark. What I want the audience, what I want you guys to take away from my experience, my self journey with having cerebral palsy is you can conquer anything you want to. It may take a little bit, but no matter what, keep on persevering and do whatever you have to do to get to where you want to be. Keep on speaking up for yourself, because that's the only way things are going to work out for you.
Great, great. Hey, how do we follow you on social media so people can follow your updates on social media?
So I am a disability influencer advocate on Instagram.
Okay.
And you can follow me for personal updates of all things people with disabilities.
Okay.
And you can follow me at Andert, all lowercase, A-N-D-E-R-T underscore, the underscore sign, symbol, and then Laura, L-A-U-R-A.
Sounds good. Thank you for being on the show. We'll have you on again, and we'll see you soon, okay?
All right. Thank you, Mark, for having me. Have a great day, everyone.
Have a great day.
Bye.
Thank you very much.
Minnesota is so fortunate to have Access Press newspaper, a disability-focused newspaper. It's the only one in the nation right here in St. Paul. With me today to talk about Access Press and all the wonderful things that it's done for 33 years is one of the board members from Access Press, Jane Larson. Well, thanks for coming on the show and being my guest. So this is exciting to be able to talk about Access Press. I know you've got a big event coming up, and we'll talk about that a little bit later in the show. Tell me a little bit about the 33 years of Access Press being this disability-focused newspaper.
Well, Access Press is the same age as the American Disabilities Act.
It is.
No coincidence. It was started by Charlie Smith and his father because they saw the need for this resource in the Twin Cities. And Access Press is there to communicate news, to advocate on behalf of people with disabilities, mm-hmm. to provide resources for people living with disabilities so that they can find out what is out there and help each other. And Charlie led the paper for 10 years.
Fabulous.
Yes, and then when he passed on, he handpicked Tim Benjamin to come to the helm of the paper, and Tim was with us for 20 years.
Yes. Talk about some of the issues that Access Press really talked about throughout those 33 years.
Okay, I'm going to talk about it a little bit from a personal standpoint,
sure.
because I've been around for a while, and I've been around for before the ADA. In fact, this is also the 50th anniversary of the Rehabilitation Act of
sure.
1973. I was around before that, and so I've seen a lot of things over the years change.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the 1980s, I was training people with disabilities for jobs in IT and doing job placement, and I remember some of the struggles that people had mm-hmm. because going to work sometimes was just like taking a flying leaf off a cliff.
Wow. Sure.
It really was because of the way benefits work and mm-hmm. People had to give up some benefits
sure.
in order to go into the mm-hmm. workplace and give up services that they need. Access Press has been incredible at providing information mm-hmm. that people can use in their own life, whether it's information on, and I'm going to mention because I do have to say one thing, and that is progress is not even. It's always two steps forward, one step back.
Right.
At least you hope it's that way, that you're making progress.
Sure.
But some of the issues that we talked about then, we still have to
exactly.
talk about. We have to keep
right.
those at the forefront. And so I think of things like personal care attendants. That was one of the things that Charlie Smith cared about.
Mm-hmm.
Tim Benjamin, at the end of his reign, we're talking about personal care attendants.
Right.
Yeah.
Which is huge.
Yeah. But all other things that have to do with employment, have to do with housing. Yes.
And I know transportation was another huge issue that you would see in Access Press.
Oh, absolutely.
Always
yes.
something on transportation.
Uh-huh. And that was another thing that I faced when I was doing work with placement, too, of people, is the transportation. It's important to have reliable, timely transportation if somebody wants to go to work.
Right.
And now, fast forward, I'm retired now, but I volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
And I volunteer in transitional services at Elm Health Fairview Hospital.
Sure.
And again, I'm working with people who it might be one of those most serious mm-hmm. times in their life when it comes to a medical point of view, what they're dealing with. And then they have to deal with everything else, like, where am I going to live? Is there going to be a place for me? How
right.
am I going to get around? Because their lives are changing.
Right.
So it's whether you live with a disability for a long time or, I mean, let's face it, getting older is chronic and progressive.
It's got its own issues that rank right up there with the disability issues, doesn't it?
Yes, we all find out
exactly.
about that, and we always have to
right.
learn to adapt.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Talk about, there's a documentary that's out there.
Yes, in 2012, 2013, mm-hmm. Access Press partnered with the Institute for Community Integration at the University of Minnesota to produce a documentary about disability and how it's represented in news plays.
Mm-hmm.
And to be honest, I saw it back then and hadn't watched it for a while because I had a DVD copy that I could no longer play on any
right.
device that I had.
Mm-hmm.
And that documentary has been made available to anyone who wants to see it. It is on Vimeo. And we're going to be talking about that at our event that's coming up because it is still relevant today. And there's people in there that you might recognize
Fabulous.
That are in that did that at the time. Some still with us. Unfortunately, some not with us.
Wow. Well,
but,
why don't we take a brief couple of minutes here and we'll show a little bit of it right now.
That would be great.
Today, many more journalists and media outlets are more careful about making assumptions and understand that to get the real story, they need to listen to the disability community.
It wasn't that we became enlightened. It was because those people in those communities with these disabilities found their voices, and they spoke up.
The disabled people themselves have redefined what it means to be disabled.
A great example is Access Press, founded in 1990 in the midst of a swelling grassroots movement that led to the passage of the Americans with Disabilities Act. Access Press was among the first disability-focused newspapers in the country.
The movement was crescendoing, and there was a lot happening, and so there needed to be an organ, a way to communicate with a community that also needed to congeal and to identify themselves so that they could continue to assert political and social power.
When the paper was first founded 22 years ago, we didn't have email. We didn't have websites. We needed something to connect the community, and Charlie understood that.
Charlie Smith, disability activist and founding editor of Access Press, exemplified the aspirations and determination of the disability community.
Charlie was irreverent, had an offbeat sense of humor, and was not about to accept the conditions that he had been handed.
Well, that was fabulous to see a couple of minutes of that clip of that documentary. That is huge for so many people. Those of us that know many people that are in there, and for younger generations to be looking at that right now as well. As you said, it's very relevant, even though it's 10 years old. So
Amazing.
Fabulous. Thanks for sharing. I'm so glad we were able to show pieces of it. And you say this is a good segue into talking about the event that's coming up.
Yes, the event. One of the things that Tim Benjamin started, and I'm going to be real honest, when he took over the paper, and newspaper business is tough, and it was a financial crisis at that time. And one of the things that Tim did that was just incredible was bringing in a flow of money to the paper. And one of the things that he started was he started an annual dinner. And it's a fundraiser, but it does so much more because it's a chance for the community to get together. It's a chance to celebrate successes of people. And every year we would give out an award, the Charlie Smith Community Award, for some individual organization that has contributed substantially to the service of the disability community.
Mm-hmm.
And
so that's the new one? That'll be focused
yeah.
more on organization
versus it will still
individual.
Be going on. Tim is, we haven't done the dinner for 6 years, and it's partly because of the pandemic, partly
right.
because of Tim's health, and that he was not able to lead this event. And we decided that we needed to have this. We needed to have this chance
sure.
to come together. People ask about it. And so we're having an event November 3rd. It's typically the first Friday in November. Last time we did this was in 2017. And in 2017, the first Friday in November, excuse me, I get my
mm-hmm.
months mixed up, was November 3rd. This year is November 3rd.
Wow.
And we're going to
That's
be
great.
Giving out the Charlie Smith Award
mm-hmm.
to Judge Donovan Frank. And the other thing that we're doing is we're starting an award in honor of Tim for what he did to sustain the paper. And that will be the Tim Benjamin Sustainers Award.
Fabulous.
And this will be the kickoff year of that. And so we're going to be having a remembrance of Tim Benjamin, and we will go forward with two awards. I'm real excited about this. And it is time that we
mm-hmm.
have a chance to recognize all that he has done.
Talk about Judge Donovan Frank and why he was selected for this year's Charlie Smith Award winner.
Well, I'm drawing a blank.
But you're trying to remember why he... Well, I know he worked, was a part of the judge at the Olmstead Act.
Yes,
and
that's
in
it.
Minnesota, with many of the issues that came up with Minnesota in violation of the Olmstead Act.
Yeah, and thank you for saying that
yeah.
because I have... This is my first time doing a TV interview, and my mind just
goes
blank.
But you're doing great.
My mind just goes blank. Thank you very much. And we're looking forward to it. And we're doing a little different event than we've done in the past. Mm-hmm. This will be at McNamara Alumni Center at the University of Minnesota. It is simply a stunning place to hold such an event. And they're going to have everything open for us, including the gallery, that mm-hmm. we can go in and see. This is a historic structure. It's also a beautiful structure.
I think it's going to be a great event. There always are. And it's been so long, the disability community will be just raring to go to party a little bit and celebrate all the good things that Access Press has done for the community all these 33 years. Yeah. So thank you so much for coming on board. And we'll put a lot of these details up on the screen while we're talking here as well, so people will have access to it. So again, thanks for coming on, and I look forward to the event coming up.
Joan, thank you very much for having me. It's nice seeing you.
Great. Thank you. And we'll be back right after these few moments.
Well, that brings to a close another action-packed show. We had a lot of great guests. Kari Sheldon, who again is the head of the Mayor's Committee for People with Disability, who does a great job over there. She's also an advocate. We had Lisa Hiebert from the Department of Public Works talking about their big event coming up in October on snow removal. And we had Laura Hiebert, who is another great advocate that shared some of her talents on this show. And Joan Willshire was here always, and she carries the show every time she's here, and had a lot of great guests too. Joan, how do you think it worked today?
It was another good show. Jane Larson, board member from Access Press, came on and really gave some good highlights of all the good 33 years Access Press has been around, highlighting the disability community efforts and fabulous outcomes at the legislature. And they've got a big event coming up in November, so that will still...
I understand it has to do with dinner.
Yes, exactly right. So it'll be another good Charlie Smith award-winning event. So can't wait for that.
Great, great. Well, as I said, Access Press is the journal of the disabled community, and it will continue, so as we hope the show will. So again, thanks for watching. Next month we'll cross 25 years on the air, and so it is our 25th anniversary show. We're not going to really do any look back or anything like that, but we'll have another great show all packaged and ready to go for you. So we hope you keep watching at home. And in my behalf, Mark Hughes and the entire staff here, heartfelt thanks for watching. Bye for now.